Hello everyone, FPL Raptor here and welcome back to another video on my YouTube channel. In today's video, I'm going to take you through my updated FPL draft. Now, as is always the case in FPL, things are changing day by day, and with every bit of news, we are tinkering and changing our drafts, and I'm sure by the time that Friday evening comes around, my draft will have changed. But I just wanted to update you on it because I've changed formation, I've changed a few of the players around that I previously had, so I just wanted to give you an update, and this will be the final update because come Wednesday or Thursday, I will be revealing my final team ahead of the Friday deadline. So without further ado, let's get into it. So guys, before we get into the actual draft, I just wanted to remind you that I have started a charity mini league. So you can see above me the code. So pause the video, go join now. Essentially with this league, it's free to enter, so don't worry about that. I will be making all of the donations and I will be donating the points totals in pennies to first, second and third in my mini league. So if you win the mini league with 2,500 points, I will donate £25 to the charity of your choice. So it's no brainer, go enter, free to enter. I want it to be the biggest charity league possible. I think we've got about 500 or 600 people in the league so far, but we can definitely get over 1,000 before game week one. So enter, share with your friends and I hope to see you as part of the league. So if we now switch back into the draft, you can see straight away it is a 3-5-2, and prior to this I was very, very keen on the 3-4-3, and I said I can't see any way in which I switch off of the 3-4-3. We'll get into in a minute the reason that I've gone for a 3-5-2 at the moment as opposed to a 3-4-3. The defense is actually very, very similar. So in my previous draft I had Backman, Trent, Shaw and Digne. So the only change is now Veltman has come into that spot, which has given me a million to play with. Trent, it's fairly obvious why we've got him. Number one for flexibility. He's the most expensive defender in the game. So if for some reason Liverpool aren't defending well, it's an easy downgrade. It's very difficult to get to Trent if you don't start with him. And he was also top for expected assists per 90 and big chances created per 90 last season. Shaw, for similar reasons, he was in the top five for expected assists and big chances created per 90. So now that we know that Luke Shaw is fit because he played the preseason game, he got an assist from a corner. He's on set pieces. I don't see any reason why I wouldn't be going with Luke Shaw with those fixtures now that we know he is definitely fit. Veltman was prior to this was on my bench and Digne was starting, and I wanted to have Veltman starting for a number of reasons. I think he's a fantastic option. Last season, for all defenders priced at 4.5 million that played over 1,500 minutes, he had the highest expected FPL points per 90. So he's arguably the best option at 4.5 million. He was sat on my bench, but I wanted to cover that Brighton clean sheet because I don't have Sanchez in my team. So I'm quite happy to now bring Veltman in and have 1 million more to play with to put into my attack. The other reason I like Veltman, I think he rotates really nicely with Luke Ayling, who's on my bench now as my first sub. So what I'll be doing is I'll be starting Trent and Shaw every single match, and I'll be rotating Veltman and Ayling depending on the fixture. I think I'll probably play Veltman for the first two game weeks at the very least, potentially the first four, and then Ayling will come in after that if I haven't already played my wild card. So that's the defense, fairly similar. Essentially what I've done is just pulled a little bit of money out of it. You can see at the moment I've got a Marty on the bench. He looks like he could start the first few games with an unfortunate injury to Fofana. So it looks like a Marty could start. Essentially, I'm just waiting for the best £4 million option to emerge. And I'm sure one will emerge over the next few days. I know the Liverpool left back, I'm not going to attempt to pronounce his name. The Liverpool left back that might fill in for Robertson, now Robertson's injured, could be a decent option. My worry about that is it takes up a third Liverpool spot. And if Robertson's injury isn't as bad as we first feared, which hopefully it isn't for his sake, it could be that that's then blocking that third Liverpool spot. He then loses his place and you ended up having to use the transfer on a £4 million defender. So for the time being, I'm happy to have the five defenders that I've got. I've got a Marty at the moment, but hopefully there is a clear £4 million defender that we can have. So let's move on to the midfield. So guys, moving on to the midfield, as I said previously, I've now moved to a 3-5-2, so there's an extra midfield slot in there taken away from the forward slot, which I'll get onto in a minute, my reasoning for that. The only thing that is exactly the same from the prior draft is that I have Salah and Fernandes still. I discussed this in detail. There is absolutely no reason to go without Salah. Their fixtures are the best in the league for the first six. He is the most consistent performer in the league. He's on penalties. He will score goals. He's a fantastic captaincy option for five of the first six game weeks. So I see absolutely no reason to go with him. I think planning ahead, it looks like I'll captain him in four of the first 6 weeks. So definitely worth having. The person that I'm looking to captain in the other 2 weeks is Bruno Fernandes, who's I'll probably captain in game week 3 and 4 against Wolves and Newcastle. So I like Fernandes in there because I think he's a good captaincy option for 3 and 4. And also, I just like the flexibility that if Lukaku and Kane get their moves and they start firing, or another big transfer happens in the Prem and we have another premium player, having two premium players to start with allows you to jump to another premium quite easily. If you only have Salah and you've got Havertz and Mahrez and your funds are spread, you basically have to early wildcard if you want to get a second premium or make 3 or 4 transfers. So I like Salah and Fernandes because I think they're fantastic options, but I also like the flexibility of being able to get to other premiums. So the other spots, we'll start with Harvey Barnes. I discussed Harvey Barnes in my differential video a few days ago. So if you haven't already watched that, after watching this video, go watch my differential video. He is one of the players that I mention in there. I think he's a fantastic option at 7 million. There aren't many other great options at 7. So if he doesn't do well in the first few game weeks, what I'll probably do is downgrade him to the likes of Saar or Harrison, and that will give me funds to use elsewhere. Harvey Barnes' underlying statistics have never been fantastic, but he does appear to be a clinical finisher over the last season at least. He finishes well. He's very, very direct, likes to have attempts on goal. He is goal hungry, and I think he's going to have a point to prove following his injury. The fixtures are actually quite nice for Leicester. They are a bit of a mixed bag, but overall across those first 6 game weeks, you'd expect him to get a few opportunities. My main worry with Harvey Barnes, the reason he wasn't in my previous drafts, is I wasn't sure what formation Leicester were going to play, whether they were going to go with 2 up top with Vardy and Daka or Vardy and Iheanacho, or whether they were going to play sort of their 4-2-3-1 formation or 4-3-3 with Barnes on the wing. And it looks like they are going for three up top with Barnes, Vardy and Perez by the looks of it, potentially all Brighton in Perez's place. So it looks for the time being like Barnes will start game week 1 and that Leicester are going to go with a formation that suits Harvey Barnes, which tells me that he is nailed and Brendan Rodgers is probably building that attack around him. So for the time being, I've got Barnes in my 11. So the next change isn't a change in price point because I've still got a £6.5 million midfielder, but it is a change in personnel. So I've brought in Rafinha for Buendia. And the main reason for that is there is now a slight worry that Buendia will be out for game week 1 with a hip injury. Now, we haven't had that confirmed yet. I think the latest was that it was a hip niggle or a minor injury. So there's still a very possible chance that Buendia is fit for game week 1. If we get that confirmation that he is fit to start, then I'll probably have him back in. I like his underlying statistics. I think he's very creative. I think feeding Danny Ings and maybe Ollie Watkins as well, I think Buendia could do really well in those first 3. But for the time being, I don't really want to take a risk with potentially injured players. So I'm going to go with Rafinha for the time being. Now, we saw last season what Rafinha is capable of. He showed glimpses of being absolutely fantastic. He managed to get 133 points in about 2,300, 2,400 minutes. So didn't play that many minutes. If he hits those 3,000, 3,100 minutes sort of range, which we know he can because Bielsa loves him and he's a starter in that team. If he can hit 3,000 plus minutes, there is a definitely a possibility that he could hit 200 points, especially if he continues to develop, if he stays on set pieces, if he continues his goal threat. So I think he is a brilliant option. My main worry with Rafinha is I don't particularly like Leeds fixtures in those first 3 or 4 game weeks. So I think I'd be more keen to have him from game week 5 onwards. However, we still expect Leeds to score in those first few game weeks. We're not expecting them to just suddenly stop scoring. So I think Rafinha will be at the heart of that and I'm happy to have him. I know a lot of people will question the fact that I've got a few clashes in this team. For example, Rafinha playing against Luke Shaw in game week 1. I don't see that as a huge issue. I think if Rafinha blank and Leeds blank and I've got the Luke Shaw clean sheet, that's great. But Luke Shaw has much more than just clean sheets. He's got the ability to get forward and get attacking returns as well. And I try not to look at FPL in game week isolation. So I'm trying to not just look at this as only game week 1. And from game week 2 onwards, I'm happy to have Rafinha and Luke Shaw because then they won't clash. So yeah, for the time being, Rafinha has replaced Buendia. But if we get news that Buendia is fit enough to start, then I'll probably make the switch back. So the 5th and final spot in my team has gone to Diogo Jota for the time being. Now, prior to that, Greenwood was in that £7.5 million spot, and I made a case that I think he's got good underlying statistics. He's got a very, very good chance of starting in game week 1, potentially game week 2 and 3. He's explosive. He has that haul potential, and I still believe all of that to be true. I still expect him to start game week 1, potentially game week 2 and 3. Martial is returning from his injury. He did start the last preseason game, so he now does look fit to start. But I think that will probably be at the expense of Cavani rather than Greenwood. So I expect Martial to start up top and Greenwood to start on the right. So both Martial and Greenwood look good options for game week one. However, Diogo Jota has looked really, really good in pre-season. He's gaining more and more fitness. He played in the Euro, so his fitness should still be pretty high. And I think Klopp trusts him now. And I think Jota's making a case that he could potentially be in Klopp's preferred front three, even once Firmino is back. Now, we can't confirm that. I know Klopp loves Firmino. But I definitely think Diogo Jota's got at least game week one in him, potentially game week two. He might then miss the Chelsea game because Firmino's trusted to do that tracking back and pressing. And then he might play game weeks four, five, six. So I really like Diogo Jota. I think he'll get at least four starts in the first six game weeks. And the other reason I like him is in those four starts, he's very, very likely to get attacking returns. So I'm just going to flash up on screen a comparison between Diogo Jota and Mason Greenwood, because this is the decision I'm currently trying to make. So this is taken from Fantasy Football Fix, and we've got underlying statistics per 90 last season between Diogo Jota and Mason Greenwood. Now, it's worth saying I do like using per 90 stats because they basically mitigate playing time. However, Diogo Jota is probably less likely than Mason Greenwood to get 90 minutes, and he does have that rotation threat from Firmino, so it's worth bearing in mind that he probably won't get 90 minutes all the time. But if we have a look at the underlying statistics, he's got more than double the goals that Mason Greenwood has per 90. He's got almost double the expected goals per 90 at 0.57, which is one of the best in the league. Takes almost four shots per 90, two shots on target per 90. The only thing that he doesn't beat Mason Greenwood in is goal assists, but he is higher in expected assists and big chances created and crosses. So potentially a slightly lower creativity, although the expected assists suggest he, and attempted assists suggest that he does also have that creativity as well. So I'm a Man United fan. I'm a big fan of Mason Greenwood. I think he's probably the better finisher of the two, although these statistics don't necessarily support that. And I do agree that Mason Greenwood is explosive and on his day could score a couple of goals, but I think the same about Jota. So for me, it probably comes down to who I'm more confident will start game weeks two and three. Because at the moment, I would be very shocked if Jota and Greenwood don't both start in game week one. I expect both to start. So really, I'm looking beyond that. So if we see any news that Firmino is really late in returning and his fitness doesn't look good, or perhaps Sancho comes back and Pogba comes back and Cavani and they all look great and we think Greenwood might lose his place, then I might go for Jota. But equally, I could go the other way. So that's the current midfield five. I'm very keen on Jota at the moment, but that spot could become Mason Greenwood. I do think that I'll be going with one or the other. And the other reason for that is I really like the look of Gundogan for game week two. He looks like he's pretty set to start with injuries to Foden and KDB. Grealish obviously needing to settle into the team. Bernardo Silva wanting to leave. I think Gundogan could settle into that role that he settled in before when KDB wasn't fit, where he was bombing forward and making those late runs into the box. He scored a brace in one of the preseason games. So I like Gundogan for game week two, and it could potentially be that I start with Jota or Greenwood, and if they don't look like they're going to start game week two and three, I make the switch to Gundogan for that game against Norwich. So I'm pretty happy for the time being with the price points in my midfield five. The only changes I might make is Rafinha back to Buendia and maybe Jota to Greenwood, but I will discuss that on Twitter and I'll show you my final team on Wednesday or Thursday to definitely say whether I've made those changes. So guys, here are the two strikers, the man on the thumbnail, Danny Ings and Antonio. So I discussed Antonio in my prior draft video in quite a lot of depth. He's one of the most injury prone players in the Premier League, but he appears to be the only striker that is just maintaining fitness through pre-season, which is crazy because people were saying don't pick Antonio because of his hamstrings, and yet he's the one that's maintaining his fitness quite well. So I really like the look of him to start. I think West Ham's fixtures, as I spoke about previously, are fantastic. So he's been in pretty much every one of my drafts and he will probably continue to be unless there are any fitness concerns with him. I've brought in Danny Ings. Now this is for a number of reasons. I think he's just an absolutely brilliant striker, brilliant finisher. His fitness looks pretty good in pre-season. He's had the opportunity to train, play a couple of friendlies with Southampton. So I like the look of Ings. I do think he'll start game week one now. I don't think fitness is a real concern. He might not play the full 90, but he does look set to start, especially now with the injury news that Ollie Watkins limped off of their last pre-season friendly with a potential issue with his knee. Buendia potentially injured as well. I think Ings will start no matter what now just because they need that quality up top. And that is what probably the main reason that I've now switched to a 3-5-2 as opposed to a 3-4-3 is there are just a crazy amount of injuries to all of the strikers. We've got potential injury concerns for Calvert-Lewin, for Watkins, Cavani's returning late. We have Wilson is always a fitness concern, despite the fact that he appears to have recovered from his previous injury. So we went from having an absolute plethora of options up top, and I couldn't decide which three to have, to potentially only one in two. And I spoke about on Twitter, I definitely think there is reason to potentially go over 4-5-1. There just don't appear to be that many strikers in the first few game weeks who are fit, have good fixtures and can be trusted. I have played with the idea of just starting with Patrick Bamford, because at 8 million, he appears to be the only striker that has had a full preseason, is looking incredibly sharp, is scoring goals, and appears to look really, really confident. And so, despite the fact, as I discussed with Rafinha, that their fixtures aren't that great, I think if there is any concern with Danny Ings' fitness or anything going on at Aston Villa, and there are lots of injuries, I'm still tempted to go with Patrick Bamford from the off. He's on penalties, as far as we know. The fixtures aren't great, but they aren't terrible. And like I said, we do still expect Leeds to score. I wouldn't be surprised if Leeds score a couple against Man United in game week one. So I am still playing with the idea of Patrick Bamford, but for the time being, I like Danny Ings. It is worth noting that one of the main reasons we want Danny Ings is we think he's definitely going to be on penalties, and that probably will be the case. However, in the last preseason friendly, El Ghazi took a penalty whilst Danny Ings was on the pitch. So it looks potentially, although that is obviously pre-season, it's a friendly, that isn't necessarily indicative of the actual Premier League. But it looks like if El Ghazi is on the pitch, he is still the number one penalty taker ahead of Danny Ings. Now, again, in the Premier League, Danny Ings might take that off him because he loves to score goals. It's also, there's also potential that El Ghazi just won't be on the pitch a lot of the time when Villa get penalties. I don't think if all of the players are fit with Bailey, Buendia, Traore, Danny Ings, Watkins, I don't think El Ghazi is in the preferred front three or even in like the preferred five options up front. So it doesn't necessarily put me off of Danny Ings, but it does make me question slightly, because one of the main reasons that we would have him above Watkins if both were fit is those penalties. So definitely something to keep an eye on. But I am very, very happy with those front two of Ings and Antonio. And I'm unlikely to change those in the coming few days. But I am still looking at Patrick Bamford as a potential option at that 8 million price point. Now, something that I just wanted to draw your attention to was the ability to use a feature on the website FPL.team to just plan ahead. Now, it's very important. You might say, yeah, my team have got great fixtures for first few game weeks, I don't need to worry too much. But there might be lots of clashes, or it might be that everyone in game week three has a really difficult fixture, and planning ahead allows you to mitigate that and choose certain players depending on their fixtures in specific game weeks. So I will link this website down below. I'm not an affiliate or anything. I just love using it. It's free to use. So it's fpl.team. And so you can enter your team and just make sure to, in before game week one, because it fetches the data through an API, after game week one, it will just use your team from the FPL website. But before that, just make sure that you save your team the first time you enter it. So what I've done is just entered the team that I've just shown you on screen. And it looks exactly like the FPL site. So you can change players on the bench. You can switch players, transfer, make the captain. So it's got a lovely user interface. I really like using it. Now, the reason I do this is I just like to see what my team looks like for the first few game weeks. So this is obviously what it looks like for game week one. But what you can do is just switch to game week two and have a look what it looks like. So you can see straight away, let me zoom in a little bit just in case that's not big enough to see. So you can see straight away, the team actually looks pretty good, pretty well set up for game week two. I don't think I would make any transfers, and I don't think I would change my bench at all. I think I would keep my team exactly how it is for game week two, obviously assuming no one's randomly dropped and no one's benched, which means two things. It means I can either potentially roll a transfer into game week three, or I can make that luxury transfer that I said previously, which is moving Jota to Gundogan. However, if Jota looks set to start game week two, I don't think Gundogan against Norwich is that much better than Jota versus Burnley. So I'll keep an eye on that, but it does give me the ability to then potentially roll the transfer into game week three. And you can see game week three, the squad looks pretty good as well. There are potentially a few further issues. So we have Liverpool are playing Chelsea, but I'd still probably want to start Trent and Salah just because we know what they're capable of. It might be that I then decide now's the time to drop Jota and to maybe someone like Sarr or Harrison and use the funds elsewhere. Or perhaps I move him on to someone else. Or I can just bring Luke Ayling in. So say it looks like Jota's definitely not going to start game week three. You can move Jota to Luke Ayling. And straight away, I'll be playing a 4-4-2. I've got Luke Ayling against Burnley and Jota first sub. Or if Amarty is still starting, that game against Norwich looks really, really good as well. So I just think this is a really nice way to plan ahead. I wanted to share it with you guys because I think it's a fantastic feature on this site and I use it all the time. And it just allows you to see. So for example, straight away, I now know that in game week 4, I've got potential issues because Barnes plays City, Rafinha against Liverpool and Ings against Chelsea. So it might be that I say, do you know what? I want to make sure that I roll a free transfer into game week 4 because I want to make 2 transfers for Barnes and Ings. Or I might say, do you know what? Maybe game week 4 is the time to play my early wild card. But at least I know that now and I can plan ahead. So yeah, I just wanted to show you this website, this feature, because I use it a lot and I think a lot of you guys could benefit from using it too. So guys, there you have it. That is my updated draft. We are so close to the deadline now, probably scarily close. So I need to start doing even more planning, even more in-depth strategies across the first few game weeks, making sure that my team is well set up just in case I don't want to play that early wild card. But I'm not going to be afraid to play the early wild card. If my team's not set up well, or I really want to attack the fixtures from game week 4 onwards, I might end up playing that wild card in the first international break. But yeah, I'm going to be doing some more in-depth research over the next couple of days. There'll be probably one more video before my final video of preseason, which will be my team reveal. And I will show you the team that I've selected. The reason that will be on Wednesday or Thursday is because on Friday, I will be at Fantasy Football Fest. If you haven't already seen, jump onto Twitter, type in FF Fest. There is an event on Friday, which I believe you can still get tickets for. It's £20. And I will be there. I'll be there with my book and I'll be there just interacting with you guys, having some drinks. So I'll be busy for Thursday evening and Friday. So I'll get my team selection video out before them. But I hope you guys have been enjoying the preseason content. I hope you guys are enjoying the content on this channel. If you are, if I could just ask you to please like and subscribe. Something like 80% of the views are still from non-subscribers. So if you're still watching this and you've watched the entire video and you're enjoying and you haven't subscribed, please do subscribe to the channel. It really helps me out. And yeah, I'll see you in the next video, which should be in the next couple of days. Thank you very much, guys.